Good day to you from ChemHelp ASAP. This video describes the recently approved drug, EXBLIFEB, which is a co-formulation of two active ingredients, cefepime and enmetazobactam. This video is a broad overview of the two components and their physicochemical and medchem properties rather than the clinical pharmacology of the drug. EXBLIFEB was approved by the FDA on the 22nd of February in 2024. The active pharmaceutical ingredients are cefepime and enmetazobactam. Cefepime has been used in drugs in the past, but enmetazobactam is being approved for the first time with EXBLIFEB and is therefore considered to be an NCE, or new chemical entity. So EXBLIFEB is the brand name of the drug, a drug that contains two active ingredients with non-proprietary names of cefepime and enmetazobactam. EXBLIFEB is approved for administration by intravenous infusion 3 times per day. The dose for each infusion contains 2.5 milligrams total of the two active ingredients. In patients with impaired renal function, the dose must be adjusted downward, and we'll talk about that in a later slide. EXBLIFEB treats complicated urinary tract infections, and the NDA applicant is Allecra Therapeutics. Allecra is based in France, and EXBLIFEB was approved in Europe by the EMA in January 2024. Enmetazobactam was originally discovered by an Indian firm, Orchid Pharma, and subsequently licensed to Allecra for development. Let's begin with EXBLIFEB's indication, complicated urinary tract infections. These are UTIs with a higher risk of treatment failure. What does that mean? Any UTI in an immunocompromised patient, in a male patient, in a pregnant patient, or associated with other factors such as kidney stones, sepsis, or catheters, is considered complicated and would fall under the approved indication of EXBLIFEB. So that is the indication. Let's now focus on the two active ingredients. One of the active ingredients is cefepime, which is a member of the cephalosporin drug class. The general structure of cephalosporins is shown to the right. Cephalosporins are a subclass of the beta-lactam antibiotics, which act as cell wall synthesis inhibitors. So on to the structure. A lactam is a cyclic amide. Here is our amide. The carbon next to the carbonyl is the alpha carbon. The next carbon is the beta carbon, and the beta carbon forms a ring on the amide nitrogen. That is the origin of the name, beta-lactam, a cyclic amide with a four-membered ring. Penicillins are another subclass of beta-lactams. Cephalosporins have a six-membered ring with a sulfur fused to the beta-lactam. Penicillins have a five-membered ring fused to the beta-lactam. Cephalosporins generally avoid some of the allergy risks associated with penicillins. The later generations of cephalosporins have also been designed to have broader antibacterial activity, such as efficacy against both gram-positive and gram-negative bacteria. That's one API. How about the other? The other API is a beta-lactamase inhibitor. Beta-lactamases are enzymes found in many bacteria that break down, hydrolyze the beta-lactam drug before the drug can exert its intended effect of inhibiting cell wall synthesis. So beta-lactamases are a defense mechanism for bacteria and are one cause of bacterial resistance to antibacterial drugs. Scientists have developed compounds that inhibit beta-lactamases, and these compounds are called beta-lactamase inhibitors. A somewhat common approach to addressing beta-lactamase-related resistance is to co-formulate beta-lactam drugs with a beta-lactamase inhibitor. This approach is exactly the case with EXBLIFEB, which includes cefepime and enmetazobactam, the second API, which is a beta-lactamase inhibitor. Enmetazobactam is shown below. Note that enmetazobactam, like all beta-lactamase inhibitors that I know, itself includes a beta-lactam functional group. The beta-lactam in this structure sacrifices itself to the beta-lactamase so that the cell wall inhibitor can survive and exert its effect. Designing antibacterials that address resistance issues is definitely an arms race between scientists and the genetic diversity of bacteria. In summary, how does EXBLIFEB work? Cefepime, the cephalosporin, inhibits cell wall synthesis. Cefepime itself carries some resistance to beta-lactamases. Enmetazobactam is included in the formulation to provide additional beta-lactamase inhibition, including extended-spectrum beta-lactamases, ESBLs, which can be problematic for many beta-lactam antibacterials. Despite advancements, EXBLIFEB is not immune to antibacterial resistance. Certain less common types of beta-lactamases can reduce the efficacy of EXBLIFEB. There are also other mechanisms of resistance, including mutations in the cell wall-producing enzymes and efflux pumps that undermine the utility of EXBLIFEB. I now want to highlight the pharmacokinetic properties of both cefepime and enmetazobactam. Both compounds have very similar values for clearance and volume of distribution, and therefore similar half-lives. The half-life is somewhat short at between 2 and 3 hours. That explains why the infusion must be performed 3 times per day. The oral bioavailability is not reported in the prescribing information. That's not surprising since the approved use is IV administration. Plasma protein binding is low for both APIs. For renal excretion, this is the percentage of the drug excreted unchanged by the kidneys. The high renal excretion is informative. High renal excretion indicates that hepatic metabolism is low, or at least relatively slow. So, going back to clearance, most small molecule drugs are broken down, cleared, by the liver. For EXBLIFEB, clearance is mostly by the kidneys. So, our clearance in the top row, total clearance, is mostly from renal clearance, as hepatic clearance, in this case, is very low. Those are my main takeaways from the PK properties. I mostly follow the discovery and development of orally administered drugs, pills and capsules. In the prescribing information for EXBLIFEB is a section on sample preparation, which is normally absent in oral drugs. EXBLIFEB is supplied as a dry powder of both combined APIs. Preparing the IV infusion requires 2 steps. First, the dry powder is reconstituted by dissolving the solid in 10 milliliters of a solution that is either 0.9% NaCl or 5% dextrose, or a mixture of 0.45% NaCl and 2.5% dextrose. This new solution is then diluted into a 250 milliliter infusion bag, with the diluent being the same composition of the reconstitution solution. In other words, if reconstitution used 5% dextrose, then the dilution should also use 5% dextrose. Once prepared, the infusion must be completed within 6 hours. It would seem that the lifetime of either cefepime or enmetazobactam in aqueous solution is limited, so the prepared solution must be used quickly to avoid chemical degradation. EXBLIFEB can lead to adverse reactions, none of which is severe. At least 5% of patients showed increased transaminases, increased bilirubin, headaches, and infusion site reactions. Hypersensitivity, possibly severe and even fatal, is possible for all cephalosporins, including cefepime. Severe allergic reactions are typically less common with cephalosporins than penicillins, but hypersensitivity is still a possibility. Diarrhea is also sometimes observed in patients taking systemic antibacterials. Finally, neurotoxicity is a risk, but it is associated with patients with decreased renal function. Therefore, the renal function of potential patients should be assessed before dosing with EXBLIFEB. Those are some highlights for EXBLIFEB, which is a co-formulation of cefepime and enmetazobactam. EXBLIFEB is an antibacterial approved by the FDA for the treatment of complicated urinary tract infections. Thank you for watching all the way to the end of this video. I hope you enjoyed this discussion of a recent FDA approval. Please consider subscribing to the channel, leaving a like, or making a comment. Take care.